But now we have discussed many light management techniques. We have seen a variety of anti-reflection coating, back reflectors, and scattering measures at the layer interface. But exactly how much can these light management techniques actually increase the light absorption in solar cells? In this video, we will learn how an imported light absorption enhancement limit, named the Yablonovich limit, is obtained. We will look at the assumptions that underlie this limit. Finally, we will discuss the actual absorption enhancement in a crystalline silicon solar cell and see to what extent the absorption can approach this famous limit. In 1982, Ilya Yablonovich was the first to theorize what the maximal intensity absorption enhancement is in a bulk absorbing layer. By assuming that an absorber layer is illuminated from one side, Yablonovich showed that a maximal absorption enhancement of 4n² can be achieved. This enhancement requires a Lamberton scatter at the front of the layer and an ideal reflector at the back. The Yablonovich limit is often used in literature to compare the effectiveness of a certain concept of light management. The theory underlying the Yablonovich limit is based on maximizing the area from which the light is incident on any point in the bulk. The derivation, therefore, can be best explained by taking a random point, for instance, the dark blue one, in the bulk of this light blue absorber layer. We first consider the case where the cell has no back reflector and no texturing. We assume the light to be incident from only one side and the absorbing layer to be surrounded by air. We indicate the maximum angle under which light can reach our point by theta. Theta equals, in this case, the critical angle for total internal reflection, as we saw in the discussion of Snell's law. We now introduce the distance R and L. L in this figure equals the maximum path length of the light reaching our point. R equals the distance from the normal to the point where L meets the surface of the solar cell bulk. We apply Snell's law to calculate theta, the maximal angle of incidence. The refractive index of air is 1 and the sinus of 90 degrees also equals 1. We therefore find that the sine theta equals 1 over the refractive index of the bulk material. And since we have a right angle triangle, sine theta also equals R over L. We can now define the amount of light trapping in the solar cell. This is achieved by calculating the solid angle under which the light can reach a point in the bulk, called the cone of incidence. We compare this solid angle to the full hemisphere from which light can theoretically reach our point. This hemisphere is denoted by omega, while the cone of incidence is denoted by delta omega. The comparison yields the following equations. And since R over L equals 1 over n, the equation simplifies to 1 over 2n squared. Now we introduce front surface texturing. We assume the front surface to be a Lamberton scatter, which means that the light is scattered evenly in every direction. Now all light incident on the front of the absorber layer can reach a point in the bulk. Delta omega and omega are therefore both equal to 2 pi. The absorption enhancements can be defined by comparing the light trapping of a Lamberton surface to that of a flat surface. This yields a performance enhancement of 2n squared. We will now look at the light reaching a point in the absorber layer bulk in the case of an ideal back reflector. We introduce the same figure again. The cone of incidence is now increased due to light reflecting off the back surface. This causes R and L to be increased as well, as denoted by the asterisks. We can see by extending the lines beyond the back surface of the cell that the relation sine theta equals 1 over n equals r over l still holds. We can now consider the light trapping enhancement in the case of a flat surface combined with an ideal back reflector. The cone of incidence still equals pi times r asterisk squared. Now, however, with an ideal back reflector, light can reach or point from all directions. This means light is incident from a full sphere rather than just a hemisphere. Omega therefore becomes the area of this sphere 4 pi times l asterisk squared. This simplifies to 1 over 4 n squared. Now we again introduce a Lambertian scatterer as a front surface. With the ideal back reflector in place, the light can again reach or point in the bulk from all angles. Delta omega therefore still equals omega. Comparing these two situations yields an absorption enhancement of 4n squared. This is the maximal absorption enhancement as defined by the Jablonovic limit. Jablonovic limit is based on three assumptions. These assumptions are among the main light management goals we work towards in order to maximize the absorption in solar cells. Firstly, the reflection at the front of the surface equals zero, so that all light is transmitted into the cell. This we try to achieve through the use of anti-reflection coatings, as discussed in preceding sections. The second assumption is that the front surface is a Lambertian scatterer, so that the light intensity is divided evenly over all outgoing angles. This scattering is improved through the use of interface texturing, targeting specific spectral ranges. Finally, for the Jablonovic limit, we assume the back reflector to be an ideal reflector. This can be achieved through the use of a dielectric back reflector, which has lower parasitic absorption than a metallic back reflector. A crystalline silicon wafer in which such absorption enhancement techniques are integrated is shown here. The crystalline silicon wafer has as nanotexturing on the front surface and a microtextured dielectric back reflector. The graph shows the absorption by the silicon layer as a function of the photon wavelength. The green line shows the 4n squared Jablonovic limit. The pink line shows the absorption for a single pass, so without any absorption enhancement techniques. We can see that theoretically, the texturing and back reflector can increase the absorption enhancement very close to the Jablonovic limit. Furthermore, we see that the theoretical performance of the dielectric back reflector is nearly equal to that of the silver metal back reflector. In reality, however, optical losses and recombination losses have to be taken into account as well. In this graph, the spectral reflection and absorption of a typical crystalline silicon solar cell are shown. This solar cell has an anti-reflection coating and aluminum back reflector. The light blue and orange lines show the maximal theoretical absorption with and without absorption enhancement techniques, respectively. The red line shows the external quantum efficiency, or EQE, of the solar cell, which will be discussed in the next section. The white top area are losses due to the reflection, and the gray and pink areas are losses due to parasitic absorptions in the aluminum layers. The green and blue areas represent the absorption in the photoactive layers. Recombination losses further decrease the cell performance with respect to absorption in the photoactive layers. In summary, we observed how the absorption in a bulk solar cell is enhanced by 2n squared if a Lambertian scatterer is introduced at the front of the bulk layer. Introducing both an ideal reflector and a Lambertian scatterer increased the absorption in the bulk by a factor of 4n squared, which is known as the Jablonovic limit. In order to achieve the Jablonovic limit, there should be no front reflection, no transmission from the back of the layer, and the scattering should be Lambertian. Finally, we discussed that well-designed solar cells with front nanotexture and a microtextured dielectric reflector can increase the light absorption very close to the Jablonovic limit. In reality though, optical losses and recombination losses decrease the solar cell performance well below the theoretical limit.